As a companion for Denis Villeneuve's upcoming adaptation of Frank Herbert's Dune, I've been exploring the characters and elements that make up this fascinating science fiction universe. With a story set approximately 20,000 years into mankind's future, many readers would expect to come across a civilization dominated by technology. However, the author saw fit to place humanity in a setting which had seen the abolition of any machines that reproduced human-like functions. As a result of this restriction, at first glance it would appear that society in many ways has moved backwards. However, while there is no longer widespread reliance on machines, based on the concept that man may not be replaced, there have been significant scientific discoveries and advancements in the way of interstellar space travel and shielding technology. The battles in Frank Herbert's Dune are largely between armies of sword-wielding warriors. In this video, I'd like to talk about how warfare has evolved throughout the history of Frank Herbert's Dune, and why the use of advanced offensive weaponry is so limited. While reliance on bladed weapons in warfare on its face seems like a regression, it is actually the result of a technological breakthrough. 10,000 years before the setting of Dune, during the time of the Butlerian Jihad, a war which saw an uprising against and subsequent banishment of thinking machines, a famed physicist and scientist by the name of Theo Holtzmann pioneered a branch of theory relating to the repellent force of subatomic particles, which came to be known as the Holtzmann effect. From his efforts, many technologies were developed to utilize this effect, such as light-producing glow globes and gravity-defying suspensors, used to levitate various objects and even people. Among the different applications that came from Holtzmann's discovery, two stand out as perhaps the biggest contributors to humanity's evolution and advancement after the banishment of thinking machines. One was the creation of a Holtzmann engine, which effectively folded space and time, allowing for instantaneous interstellar travel. Another was the development of shielding technology. These shields contained Holtzmann generators, which produced a field derived from phase one of the suspensor nullification effect. These shields had the ability to block incoming projectiles and could be calibrated to allow the passage of material that traveled below a set speed. This was necessary since if all matter were not allowed to enter the shield, any individuals inside would suffocate. The primary weapons used in the Dune universe were various swords and knives, projectiles, and laser guns. However, as the use of personal shields became more widespread, the use of conventional projectile weapons became partly obsolete. Before personal defensive shields had become commonplace, the weapon preferred by most armies were laser guns. The reason why these fell out of general use was that if contact was made between a laser gun and a shield, it would result in a nuclear explosion that could potentially kill everyone within a large radius. Because of this, hand-to-hand combat with the skillful use of blades came to once again dominate ground-based warfare. With a Holtzmann shield, if a blade was moved slowly enough, it would be able to penetrate the energy field. In order to fully take advantage of this one small vulnerability, new styles of fighting and martial arts were developed to be slow on attack and fast on defense. By the time of the first Dune novel, the most extreme forms of martial arts came from the Bene Gesserit, with their exercise of Prana Bindu, also called the Weirding Way, hand-to-hand combat techniques developed from supreme muscle and nerve control. The Emperor's mighty Sardaukar warriors were also quite formidable in ground combat, as well as the swordmasters of the Ginas, whose training was largely focused on fighting with a blade. While a personal shield is commonplace to ensure one's safety throughout the universe, there is one planet in which such a device would mean disaster for the wearer. On Arrakis, the deadly jewel of the universe, the mighty sandworm reigns supreme. These beasts have been known to be enraged and driven into a frenzy by the rhythmic sounds produced by personal shields, and so any battle in the deep desert must be done without these devices. Because of this, warfare in the deep desert of Arrakis is dominated by personal firearms and projectile weapons. In this area, the native Fremen warriors therefore have a unique tactical advantage over all other opponents in warfare involving firearms. Another use for shielding technology in the universe of Dune is to protect key buildings and fortifications. In attacking a shielded fortification, there are a couple of methods which have been known to be effective. One way would be to sabotage the shield generators from within, Another method is to overwhelm a shield with large amounts of mass and kinetic energy. This could be done using a vessel called a crusher, which is a military space vehicle that could form into a larger vessel designed to fall on a target, effectively crushing it. Given the destructive results of the interaction between a laser gun and a shield, many have wondered why the militaries of the Great Houses did not simply deploy kamikaze troops, so to speak, in order to wipe out enemy forces. Although this kind of action is not unheard of, there are a few reasons why this tactic is rarely deployed in war. Shortly after the destruction of the thinking machines, a historic treaty called the Great Convention was brokered between the Imperium, the Great Houses, and the Spacing Guild. This treaty prohibited the use of atomics against human targets. Strict rules were also put in place for wars and feuds. Because of the nuclear nature of the explosion caused by a laser gun beam's interaction with a shield, this kind of attack would fall under the atomic category prohibited by the Great Convention. Any violation of that treaty would most certainly result in swift and harsh retribution from the combined forces of the Empire and Houses of the Landsrad. While the use of atomic weapons against human targets is prohibited, the Great Houses did hold nuclear weapons called family atomics, which were passed down from generation to generation in the noble families as weapons of last resort. Because of the retaliation that would be triggered by the deployment of these weapons, they remain largely unused. Another provision made under the Great Convention in order to protect innocent bystanders was an allowance for a limited form of warfare called a War of Assassins, in which the assassination of nobles and high government officials was allowed. This was a provision in which formal declarations of intent were required, and where only certain kinds of weapons and practices were permitted, as outlined in the Assassin's Handbook. Because of this, even during times of peace, poisons in food and drink are of constant concern. Subsequently, the Great Houses tend to rely on mechanical devices called poison snoopers, which would detect poison in food or drink in their dining halls. Another effective assassination tool is the remotely operated, floating, tadpole-like machine called a Hunter Seeker. This machine was equipped with a needle tipped with a quick-acting, lethal poison. The Landsrad also allowed for acts of formal feud, or vendetta, referred to as canley. Similar to ancient duels on Earth, the act of canley was originally created to allow disputes to be resolved without any harm being brought upon innocent bystanders. This animosity continued from father to son until the last child was dead or the two families made peace. The monopoly on space travel held by the Spacing Guild made it so that the guild held the status of final arbiter on who was allowed to wage war against whom, as without the Spacing Guild's highliners, there would be no practical way of transporting armed forces. Also, because of the guild's grip on space travel, there were generally no conflicts in space either. With all of these rules and circumstances in place, warfare in the Dune universe is shaped in a way that feels unique among other futuristic settings. In Dune, Frank Herbert effectively flipped science fiction on its head with the realization of the counterintuitive effects that technological progress could have on society. His world-building results in a return to a sort of medieval warfare, where with skill and training, the individual can make a real impact on almost any battlefield. But I'm curious to know what you think of the unique way in which Frank Herbert molded the rules of combat and warfare in his series. Are there certain kinds of fighting styles or weapons from the series you would like to see showcased on screen? Let me know your thoughts in the comment section below. I hope you enjoyed this video. Leave a like if you did, and be sure to subscribe for more Dune and other sci-fi and fantasy news and lore. Thank you all so much for your support. And as always, have a very nerdy day.